Let's start off today by asking, how are you feeling about step one? It's high stakes, low reward, right? It's pass fail, so you don't get any credit for doing well on it. But if you fail it, it just makes getting a residency very, very difficult, not even to begin to discuss the embarrassment. Do you have a plan, and have you practiced? It's not enough to try harder, it just isn't. And so we ask ourselves, why am I so worried? And I think you have to differentiate at this point between anxiety and tension. Anxiety is when you have high stakes and you don't know what's expected. Tension is when you have high stakes and you know you just got to go and execute. Remember that performance equals talent times effort times directed effort squared. I have done thousands of students in step prep and teaching them medicine, and I can promise you, every one of them tried really hard, and it doesn't have to show up in results. You've got to go to the essence of step one, which is two principles. Clinical medicine is built on a foundation of basic medical sciences. The second idea is you've got to use your facts in patient care. And that's just simply, you got to think like a doctor. Step one is a clinical exam, which means it's patient-centered. 70% of your exam is going to be a clinical vignette that's fundamentally based on pathophysiology. So everything starts and ends with, do you have a hard, clear, tight grasp of the pathophys for all your disease processes? You know, you go to Robbins, it's not there. If you don't believe me, I'll just ask you, go take a look at Robbins and say, how much lab testing do they have? How many x-rays do they have? Because remember, testing teaches pathophysiology. Well, Robbins has 20 different types of testicular tumors. That's great for a first-year pathology resident. It's not what your step one exam is going to be. Let's talk about what you're doing now. You're doing what everyone around you does. And you ask, well, what do they know? And the answer is, well, they don't. And I know what all of you do. I teach thousands of you. You all want to memorize. Every one of you can do first aid. I love first aid. First aid is a great list of what you have to know. But open any page in first aid and ask, why do I need this in patient care? And if you can't answer it, you're just memorizing a list. That's not going to help you with how do doctors use it in patient care. You're going to do all of your U worlds. U world is fine. It's pretty good. It used to be perfect. Now I get really wide ranges of comments. Sometimes students say U world really helped them. Lots of students say it had nothing to do with it. And the answer is, how close is your exam going to be to a patient walks in the door? Do you know what to do next? How do we learn medicine? Everything I know how to do is because I've tried things that failed. You know, I've been doing this for over a decade now. It's all based on practical teaching experience with you guys. And I can tell you this, if you want to learn pathophysiology, you have to have a mental picture and you have to tell me the story that goes with it. How do you think about congestive heart failure? How do you think about any of these renal diseases? If that doesn't work, and it usually does, but sometimes it doesn't, then you have to have the right table. And of course, there's that blessed thing that we have in clinical medicine called the algorithm. So if you have got those three things, an image with a story, a really tight table, or a really good algorithm, trust me, you're just first aiding yourself. It's all brute memory, and it's not going to go well. And that's why you're anxious. So that's what we're going to do. I come out of decades of clinical practice and fell hard in love with teaching. It's really easy for me to say, how do you think about, because I've been doing it all my life. That's not the same as saying, I know how to teach you to do it. That's what I've spent the last 10 years doing. The hardest thing coming out of clinical practice is, what is a first and second year student ready to understand? So this is going to be starting at your level. We're going to learn all the pictures and their stories. We're going to repeat them a million times in a million different ways until you are going to think the same way I do, which is the same as the people who write your step one exam. So, yep, lots of work. We're not pretending it's easy, but I promise you, everything will be sticky. You'll know why you're learning it. You know what's expected on your exam, and you're going to have a great clerkship experience. So there's only one way you're going to get this, which means you have to subscribe. So if you haven't pushed subscribe yet, hit the button and let's start the trip together. There are lots of resources. Everybody loves you, world. Everyone has a copy of first aid. So why should you listen to me? You shouldn't. You shouldn't trust anyone. The single biggest problem I have when I first start teaching students is they don't trust anyone. And you know, I got to tell you, you're right. You shouldn't. We have a broken system in which you don't go to your lectures because they aren't helpful. So the first thing I have to prove to you is I have the right to an opinion. I come out of 35 years of clinical practice, and not just any practice. I come out of small hospital pathology, which means I have a really broad experience from autopsies, including forensic autopsies, which are sudden deaths, worked with ERs and protocol blood transfusions, running all the clinical labs, built research labs myself, surgical pathology for decade after decade. I didn't even know I liked teaching until I was 50. The first thing you've got to do to have an opinion is you've got to come out of patient care, and it should be broad patient care. Okay, that's necessary. It's not sufficient because you also got to be able to teach. And I just don't mean, hey, kid, come over and see this interesting case. I mean, you have to teach all of your subject, all of pharmacology, not just pharmacology, the CNF. That's a subject specialist. You've got to be able to come in and say, well, I'm teaching pathology, but I could teach immunology if I needed to. I could do anatomy if I needed to. I mean, everyone uses the word integrated. We're going to talk about that word a lot because you should be able to start with your patient and walk all the way through disease to the molecular level, no gaps. That makes you a medical educator. And frankly, I've spent over a decade learning to do that, and it's nearly killed me, and it isn't easy, but you don't have to learn it because I've done it for you. So why should you believe me? Yeah, I've spent decades in patient care. I'm a real doctor. I'm a medical educator, thousands of students for a decade, all of it exam-based, so I'm measured on my performance. I can cross-teach any subject that you want. And boy, you're just going to understand. We're going to be talking about an inflammation, and I'm going to be talking about the chemotactic factors. If you can find anyone that's done more than that, call me and we'll all go learn from them. Remember, clinical medicine is built on a foundation of basic medical sciences. And we should think of all of medicine as diagnosis and treatment. I mean, that's the universe, frankly. But remember, diagnosis and treatment are built on pathophysiology. If you can do pathophysiology, you can do two-thirds, three-quarters of medicine. All learning and all understanding is based on pathophysiology. So that's what I teach. And I've taught it so long to so many people, frankly, I kind of got tired of repeating myself. So I wrote it all down. It's a clinical pathophysiology book. It's going to be the foundational document of everything I teach you. You're going to spend your life with me learning how to think and use that document. And you're going to need a copy of it. To get it, you're going to click the description link here. How is my teaching going to be different than everyone else's? Well, first off, we're starting with patient care. A patient-centered approach means we have to have a chief complaint with a number of differential diagnoses. And here's the killer. The ability to do a differential diagnosis always and ever comes back to pathophysiology. So the real question is, given it's patient-centered, chief complaint differential, how are you going to teach me pathophysiology? To teach you pathophysiology, I'm going to start with a mental image. And I'm going to draw that on a blank piece of paper for you, because you're going to have to draw it too. So we're going to draw this picture, and then we're going to walk through the story of that pathophysiology, so that every time I say something like left ventricular congestive heart failure, you can give me a long axis view of the heart, you can walk me through homeostasis and adaptation, and then you're going to failure backing up to pulmonary edema. So all of a sudden, I suppose it's a type of memorizing, but it's not lists, it's not Anki cards, it's not the dragons. It is literally the pictures you're going to see for the rest of your life and the story you're going to give to it. And we're going to do that together with whiteboard teaching. And oh, by the way, if I draw it, it's because it's my mental image, which means it has to be yours. If you can't draw it, you don't know it. So you've put in the work. You can draw me out left ventricular congestive failure and all the key pathophysis we're going to do. And you're going to say, got it. How do you know you have it? Isn't that always the worry? You spend 2 hours studying and you sort of go, did I do enough? Did I do the right thing? Well, at the end of the day, you have to come and test yourself. And there's three ways you're going to do that. The first, obviously, is multiple choice questions. But they've got to be the right multiple choice questions. They've got to be the questions that say, are you using the image? Great way to do it is case studies, right? Case studies mean you have to read the clinical description, and they almost always end up with some sort of testing teaches pathophys. But ultimately, the best is to come and talk to a medical educator. So part of what we're going to do is we're going to have live meetings, and you're just going to come and I'm just going to say, hey, tell me about what you thought, and we're going to let the conversation go where it will. So I do that a lot with students, especially clinical clerks who bring me their cases, and we go clinical medicine's built on the foundation of basic medical sciences. In our community, you're going to see three ways of checking yourself. Multiple choice questions, I know you love them. Case studies, I love those. And then live discussions in which the conversation flows across lots of different ways of thinking of things and really are the acid test for, are you part of this conversation or you don't know enough? So where does this all end up with respect to step one? Step one is a clinical exam that tests two principles. Can you think like a doctor using clinical medicines built on a foundation of basic medical sciences? And that foundation is overwhelmingly pathophysiology. So if you come into this way of having a mental image you can tell a story about, step one exam is kind of fun. Students have told me they'll read questions and they'll look up with a smile on their face because it's literally what we teach. And they look around and realize, no, of course, that's an inside story. None of this is tricks. None of this is memorizing little silly mnemonics. None of it is that. All of this is how doctors think about disease and why they think that way. Come and think like a doctor, and your exam will take you from anxiety, what's going to happen to me, to tension. I know what I got to do. All I got to do is execute. Come join our community. To do that, you're going to have to subscribe to our channel. And when you do, you're going to enter this world of clinical doctors that want to be better doctors because they understand the basic sciences that clinical medicine is built on. In other words, think like a doctor. This is the key to your step one exam. And that's going to consist of all the things that you can imagine. It's going to include our textbook, all of the images we talk about, multiple choice questions that are going to truly be pathophysiologic. Did you understand that concept? Case studies that are going to go through all of the transition from a chief complaint and differential and testing teaches pathophys. It's going to include weekly what I'm thinking about. I teach a lot and I'm always learning. So for example, I had a great session with the students last night and I realized I didn't really understand neonatal respiratory distress syndrome. Did you know it sort of comes in two parts, early and late? Well, I learned that this morning. So that's the kind of thing I'm going to be sharing with you. It's kind of fun for me and it will sort of break out of this stale memorizing you're in to sort of someone who loves medicine, come love it with me. And then at the end, we're going to have live topics, always the best, and you guys come and talk about what we need to, and we'll start with a cough and end up in God knows where protein world. Come and join a community, learn to love medicine, and stop being afraid of your exam.